Welcome to another Eric Waite Whiskey Studies, and I want to thank you for joining me in my study of the history of Scotch whiskey. In this video, we're going to be covering basically the 1980s, the era that they refer to as the Whiskey Lock or Whiskey Lake. At the same time period, there was a wine lake in Europe, particularly in Italy. Here in the United States, it wasn't so bad. In fact, the 1980s was doing for the United States, Napa Valley was doing really, really well. 1976, Napa Valley essentially came onto the map, and Napa Valley and California as a whole was doing really, really well. But there was a glut, they say, in the market in wine, mostly in Italy and old world countries. But I really don't believe that there was ever, or nor will there ever be, a whiskey lock or whiskey lake. The term implies that there's too much whiskey. I don't believe you can have too much whiskey. The problem isn't that you have too much whiskey. The problem is you don't have enough whiskey drinkers. So it's not a lock or a lake of whiskey. That's the problem. It's a drought in whiskey drinkers. Alrighty. But that's just my take. I mean, seriously, do you ever think I would assert that you could have too much whiskey? Hey, so during this, Teddy, I'm going to return to a bottle that I picked up in June 2018 from a distillery. This is from Cardew Distillery. This is a Cardew single malt Scotch whiskey. This is a limited edition, only available from the distillery. And this is one out of 1,800 bottles. Cardew is primarily known for being a contributor to Johnnie Walker blends. So you don't see a lot of bottlings of it, let alone, you know, the special limited edition versions. Not the most complex wine in the world, just sort of an easy drinker. But I'm in the mood for having something that's not peated, not overly sherried. And that's just the mood I'm in. So that's what I'm drinking. Alrighty, let's get into the notes. In the early 1980s, production tumbled dramatically, with the 1976 level of production virtually being halved during 1981 and falling to a low of 35.9 million gallons in 1983 as the industry's old problems of boom and bust struck once more. As in the past, expansion of distilling capacity came to outstrip demand, especially as consumption levels in the key North American market fell, and the press eagerly dubbed the overproduction of Scotch the Whiskey Lock, as a parallel to the EEC, Wine Lake, which was making news at the time.
The Wine Lake refers to the continuing supply surplus of wine produced in the European Union.
So, what are the contributing factors? There's probably a multitude of them. One of the things, and my notes don't really go into this, but from my understanding and study of wine, is people switched beverages, right? I think wine was becoming more popular, particularly North American wine was becoming more popular. Old world wine, particularly Italy, was becoming less popular. So the reason why there was too much Italian wine, or because it was poorly made and couldn't compete with North American wine, particularly California wine, and maybe even Bordeaux wine. And so the market shifted to a different place. Same thing with whiskeys. You know, we saw earlier in the notes, when you go from a queen to a king, you go from Scotch to champagne drinkers. It's not that they're not drinking at all, they're just drinking something different. And so what has to happen is, you can't be stuck to a particular model for branding and getting people to want to drink your whiskeys. So old advertisements for Scotch whiskey, they had, you know, the typical, you know, a Scotsman in his kilt, you know, and sort of the hunting dogs and all that sort of a thing. Well, I know people eschew, that people don't really like marketing and they think it's a bad name, and that's because there's too much bad marketing. But what needed to happen is a shift in the persona and the perception of Scotch whiskey so that it would seem more hip. This was the same thing that happened in Japan. Japanese whiskey fell out of favor with a particular generation because it was seen as the older person's drink. And so the next generation switched to clear spirits and cocktails and so forth. A lot of that is a contributing factor to the 1980s because the lock isn't due to, you know, taxation issues. It isn't due to too much grain issues. It isn't due to a whole lot of other issues that we saw in the past. It's just that there weren't enough consumers. Or why weren't there enough consumers? Because the brand or the idea or the perception of brown spirits or whiskey was seen as the old man's drink. All right, let's move on. 1983, Highland Distilleries closed its Bonehaven facility on Islay on a temporary basis and put all its other distilleries on short-time working. Worst affected, however, was the Mighty Distillers Company Limited, which responded to the crisis by announcing the closure on 31st of May 1983 of Banff, Brora, Dallas Dew, Glen Alban, Glen Vore, Glen Lochy, Knock Dew, Northport, and St. Magdalene Malt Distilleries, along with Carsbridge Grain Distillery. Alrighty, and let's take a wee whiff. It actually has light pear, peach, yellow apple notes, a little bit of maltiness, some nice vanilla notes. The funny thing is, I'm actually salivating. Just smelling the whiskey makes me salivate, which then makes me stutter on my words. Some oak notes, baking spices, sort of vanilla, cinnamon, nutmeg on the palate. It's bottled at 48% alcohol by volume. It has nice intensity of flavor. On the palate, I'm actually getting more tropical notes. I get like pineapple and banana. I get peach, like a fuzzy peach. The apple is still there. Pear is definitely there. A lot of vanilla. There's like a vanilla pudding. In fact, there's like a vanilla wafer, vanilla pudding. It's actually quite nice. When I had originally reviewed this, and the link to my review would be down below, I wasn't all that impressed. But see, now it's had time to open up, and it's showing itself a lot better. So I'm actually much more impressed with it than I was before. But let's get on with our notes.
Tomatin Distillery was put into liquidation in January 1985, paying the price for its energetic expansion program of previous years, and the situation was still very grave for Distillers Company Limited. DCL followed up its 1983 distillery's rationalization program with the closure on 31st of March 1985 of a further 10 malt distilleries, namely Royal Blackla, Colburn, Conville Moor, Glenesk, Glentauchers, Glenurry Royal, Imperial, Monachmore, Millburn, and Tinanik, while the older parts of Glendullen and Linkwood were also shut down. Just as with its attitude to supply of grain, these well-known malt distilleries were simply shut down and demolished.
So, of some of the lost distilleries, some get revived, some demolished, and they end up putting shopping malls and other business properties on it. Some, the facilities remain, but they've been converted into restaurants, apartment complexes, and some of the architectural interests are still there. So in some of the pictures you see, you'll actually see some of the ruins. Some of them make the buildings, most of it maintained as apartments or restaurants. And then one of them is actually a grocery store. Now Safeway's now stands where the distillery once was. Very, very, very sad. Some of the whiskeys, by the way, of these lost distilleries can be found. In fact, there is a company called Lost Distilleries Company, and the Scotch for Dummies just did a review of one. So independent bottlers bought up the cask, and so you can still find some of these lost distillery whiskeys around, but usually you're going to get them through independent bottlers. All right, let's get on with our notes. The issue of Off-License News for the 5th of April 1984 had already given some context for DCL's problems, noting that in 1971, DCL had a 50% share of an overall 8 million case market. By 1981, while the market had grown by 66%, DCL's share was actually down by a third to just under 3 million cases out of a total volume of 13.3 million cases. And in 1983, according to one firm of stockbrokers, DCL sales slipped further to 2.4 million cases out of 12.5 million cases, and its share dropped below 20% for the first time. Put another way, DCL was selling less scotch in the UK in total with all its brands than Bell's was selling with just one line. And let's take another sip. Nice. DCL's problems in some ways had nothing to do with whiskey, but with its association with the thalidomide scandal. Thalidomide is a drug which was then produced by the DCL subsidiary, Distillers Biochemicals Limited, and used to prevent morning sickness during pregnancy. It had the serious side effect of deforming the fetus in the womb. Throughout the 1960s, DCL was regularly in the news as it battled in the courts with the families of those who suffered. This badly damaged its reputation, together with the difficulties associated with paralleling in Europe, resulted in a loss of about 25% of the home trade. This provided an opportunity for competitors to position their brands in the UK and European market. 1970, Highland Distilleries purchased Matthew Gloge & Son Limited, the Perth wine merchants and blenders of the famous Grouse brand, which was then little known but was to become a market leader. According to Moss and Hume, in their book, The Making of Scotch Whiskey, a prominent feature of the period was the growing involvement of brewery companies in distilling. And Watney Mann had bought International Distillers and Vintners Limited in 1972 before being absorbed by Grand Metropolitan later the same year. Allied Breweries acquired William Teacher & Sons Limited in 1976, while Whitbread had purchased Long John International Limited from Shenley Industries Limited the previous year. However, one of the most significant takeovers, and one which prefigured future high-profile developments, came in August 1985 when Guinness PLC took over Arthur Bell & Sons Limited for £370 million as a result of a hostile bid. Bell's was the UK's best-selling brand of blended Scotch whiskey, a position which it had enjoyed since the late 1970s when DCL fell from grace. The perceived vulnerability of the Distillers Company Limited, owners of the global best-selling Scotch whiskey Johnny Walker, led to the Argyll Group launching a £1.9 billion bid for DCL on the 2nd of December 1985. DCL responded by approaching Guinness to act as a white knight and make a rival offer. They did so with a figure of £2.2 billion, at which point Argyll countered with £2.23 billion bid in February 1986. The Guinness approach was cleared by the Monopolies and Mergers Commission, and the brewer countered Argyll with a £2.447 billion bid, countered by Argyll's £2.54 billion final offer. Guinness stuck with the previous figure, which was accepted by DCL in April, making Guinness PLC the new owners of Distillers Company Limited, and bringing to an end one of the great eras in Scotch whiskey industry. The following year, the group distilling business, including Bell's, was brought together under a new subsidiary, United Distillers. Ultimately, a Department of Trade and Industry inquiry established that several leading figures in Guinness, including Chief Executive Ernest Saunders, had attempted to manipulate the stock market to inflate Guinness's share prices to assist the bid for DCL. And Saunders and two former colleagues served custodial sentences as a result. And let's take another sip. It's also very creamy, very glossy. It has a nice round mouth coat feeling as well. It actually has a fairly decent long finish. That's, I would say, medium plus length finish as well. It's slightly sweet. And when I get on the back end, it's very much a sort of vanilla banana pudding character to it. Really, really like it. To most outsiders, and even many within the venerable organization, DCL has seemed invulnerable, and its acquisition by Guinness was another sign that the old order was changing. During 1987, the brewing industry continued to increase its stake in Scotch whiskey when Hiram Walker Scotland Limited was taken over by Allied Breweries, with Allied Distillers Limited being established to run the company's UK spirit operations. By this time, the Scotch whiskey industry was beginning to recover some of its previous buoyancy, with output of malt spirit rising from 102,908 liters in 1986 to 115,974 liters during 1987, and the trend of growth continued through the rest of the decade. In terms of grain spirit, production had plummeted from 257,063 liters in 1979 to a low of 145,698 in 1983, with a modest rise the following year. Subsequently, output grew during the late 1980s to restore a level in excess of 200,000 liters. Inverhouse closed Moffat Distillery. So what can a whiskey business do when it seems that there's a shifting attitude towards whiskeys, or particularly Scotch? Well, this is something that Japan has done really, really well. When the younger generation wasn't drinking Japanese whiskeys, it did two things. One, a movie came out about the founder of Japanese whiskeys. That brought popularity and notoriety to Japanese whiskeys. And the second thing it did was it shifted its focus to cocktails, particularly the highball. So rather than trying to sell just Japanese whiskey as Japanese whiskey, they also made popular the whiskey highball as a cocktail. And so the shift focused to, you know, be able to sell younger spirits because they had lacked enough whiskey to meet demands with the increase. And so shift to a focus of, hey, here are these whiskeys you can make highballs with. In fact, they even started canning highballs in a can. And you just have to rebrand and remarket. Now, we Scotch enthusiasts, purists, we don't want anyone screwing with our brands, right? That's something that we don't want. So what a company has to do, what a distillery has to do, is sort of diversify. Here are some whiskeys for the whiskey lovers, for the those who really know what they're doing. But here's how we'll also come up with another line and brand it towards a different, younger, or different generation. Now, we may stick our noses up at those other whiskeys, but the other generation who's drinking, you know, the cocktails, these simple whiskeys, now they will grow up to be mature, more sophisticated whiskey drinkers later, right? So if whiskey, Scotch whiskey, it maintains itself in the market and they're not losing business, then we can't complain about these other brands or these other ways of branding or these other lines that are coming out. It's not for you. It's for another tier of marketing. It's for another generation and not for you. So if you're gray, or you would be gray if you weren't completely bald, realize, not every whiskey or brand is going to be for you. And sometimes, you know, distilleries have to shift in order to remain alive and relevant. All right, that's it for this study. In our next video, we're going to focus a little bit more on the phenomenon of single malts and the rise in popularity of single malts, which we all like. You know, blends make up about 90% of production. You know, 10% makes up single malts, and yet most of us like to focus on single malts, right? All right, but we're going to get into that in our next video. If you subscribe to this channel, I want to thank you very much. If you haven't yet subscribed, but you like watching my videos, I would greatly appreciate it if you would subscribe, give this video a thumbs up, and share with your friends on Facebook, Twitter, and other social networking channels. And until next time, live long and prosper. Thank you.